Y'all know what that sound means. It's old Uncle Ted coming in with some freedom ringing in you. That means it's time for the Triple T, baby. That's right. It's Tackle Talk Tuesday, live coming at you from the Your Lake Fort Guide Big Bass Dojo. Cheers. Let's get it, y'all. If you've never been to the Triple T before, we like to start it off with a little bit of Uncle Ted Nugent every time. There's a lot of bass acting like dogs in heat right now. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Also, if you guys have never been on one of the Triple T Tackle Talk Tuesdays before, what we like to do is talk a little bit about top tackle tips, different things you can do with your tackle to try and get you some more fish, just some little tricks and tips. We also like to ask tons of questions. We do this live every Tuesday night. Well, every Tuesday that I can get to the live stream. We do it most Tuesday nights. I will say, going forward, I will try. I'll explain to you guys why I missed a couple Tuesdays. Going forward, we'll try to get back on track doing it every Tuesday like we used to. Hey, we're going to give you tackle tips. We're going to answer questions. We're live both on YouTube as well as Facebook right around 8:30 p.m. Central Standard Time on those channels, both Your Lake Fort Guide on both platforms. Y'all know how we do it, man. It's been a long day today. It's been a windy, little bit of a tough day. But tonight, we're going to get into soft plastics. We're going to discuss why soft plastics catch probably about 70% of the total bass caught right now. Maybe 80 or 90%, to be honest with you. Soft plastics really shine this time of year. It's time for you guys to load up on a variety of soft plastics. We're going to show you a variety of good ones that I lean on this year. We're also going to show you guys some of the ones, I don't know if you'd call them top secret. We're going to reveal some top secret plastics. Maybe not so much top secret as they are overlooked. It's not that they're super secret. I mean, people know about the baits, but they're certainly overlooked. So to me, that makes them somewhat top secret baits. We always like to give away them top secret guide tips right here on Your Lake Fort Guide. Get the brown in your cup, folks. Hold it up. Drink it down. It's a Triple T. Cheers, y'all. Let's get it. Fade on Uncle Ted now so we can get to the business of tonight. Let me say some hellos and how you doing to some of the folks in the chat. I always like to say hi to tell you guys, man. I can't appreciate you guys enough for joining us tonight. We got over 100 people between the two platforms right now already before we've even got started. So thank you guys. Thank you so much. I live a dream life. It's because of each and every one of you guys. So thank y'all. Sincerely, thank you so very much. Let me say some hellos and how you doing to some of the folks in the chat over here on the Facebook side. We got Victoria Limbell, Jerry Dean, Junior's in the house, Mr. Smith, Matt Strange, John Sykes, Jeremy Thomas, Shannon Snully, Elliot Davis, Jeff Walling, Casey Risner, Roy Organez in the house, Andre Daughtry, Ryan Williams, John Jr., Joe Dickerson. The list goes on and on and on. Let me go over to YouTube and say some hellos and how you doing. We got Ken Simpson, Russell Strowman, Todd Fleischer, TF. TF, I'm coming to one of y'all shows in April, April 21st at Shreveport, I think we're going. Super Dave, Billy Snow, fishing with JC, Brian Muirhead, Michael Eatons, Ben Shobe, Rocky Shu, and so many more, man. Thank you guys for joining us as you always do on Tuesdays. Hey, before we get into tonight's tackle, talk about plastics. One thing, boat lanes. We got our boat lane. We might as well go on and get into some Lake Fork drama while we're at it. Let's get into some. I know you guys dig on the Lake Fork drama a little bit, so let's jump off just straight off into that. We got some Lake Fork boat lanes that you boys been working on. In fact, the reason I've missed some live streams lately, quite frankly, was last week I had my kids on spring break, and I was trying to juggle spring break and their soccer practice and game schedule, which I coach their team. And then on top of that, I have been spending every waking extra second that I have, and even scheduling days off from guiding, like costing myself thousands of dollars to build what I feel is hands down, no questions asked, it ain't even close, by far the best and most detailed boat lanes chip, that navigation chip that has ever been offered for Lake Fork. I have overlaid the other trails on top of it. There's nothing anywhere close to the amount of trails that we have going across the lake. There's nothing anywhere close to the amount of hazard waypoints and caution waypoints that we have to give you guys the information on what areas you can run wide open and what areas you got to slow down. And hey, you might even need to idle it till you get used to keeping your boat on that line. We've got hazard waypoints that let you know exactly how far away the hazards are on those trails where it does get a little bit tight and dangerous, including some of the buoyed boat lanes that we've had forever. There are some of those that get a little bit tight in areas. Hey, we went ahead and marked some hazard waypoints on some of those for you as well. So just more information than has ever been offered on any navigation system or assistance that anything that's been put out there before. It's just hands down more information. I've seen the other ones in comparison to it. There ain't no comparison. No offense to anybody that's come before me. I just don't think anybody's ever taken the time to idle into every single corner of Lake Fork like I've been working on literally for the last three and a half months. This started in mid-December when they announced they were going to drop the lake 6 foot low. And when it started dropping down, I think I started 5 foot low. This project started way back then in December. So I've been working on this for the better part of 3 months. And I have idled into every single corner of Lake Fork at this point over those 3 months on my days off than when I could and days that I scheduled off. Like I said, had scheduled some days off where I didn't guide and do all that. If there's a lane that you can run back into a corner of Lake Fork, we got it marked. Some of them are tight. This is going to be a use at your own risk product, folks. This ain't going to be plug that thing in, keep your boat near that line, and you're safe. No, that's not how this works. This is a use at your own risk product, and we are going to make sure you understand that, make sure you understand how to use it. It's going to come with a instructional sheet inside of it. Make sure that you guys are well informed on how to use this chip properly. It does have lines marked in two different colors where you can navigate safely at 6 foot low and above. So the level we're at now and above, you can run those lines right now. It also has a different colored set of lanes that are good once the lake reaches 3 foot low and above. So once we get to 3 foot low and up, then all the lanes on that chip will be safe to run. Right now, the ones that are marked 3 foot low and up, those aren't good to run until we get to that water level. So keep that in mind. Again, this is a use at your own risk type of deal. Here's what I do know. If you go and buy the Lance Vick chip or the Stephen Fothery chip, which we've had forever and are very good products, there are lanes on both of those that you cannot run right now. If you run all the lanes on those right now, you're going to hit stumps on some of those lanes. On ours, we wanted to make sure that you guys had the ability to know, hey, at 6 foot low, I can run these lanes. At 3 foot low, I can run these lanes. Give you guys a little bit of comfort and confidence in that. So really thought about it from the weekend angler's perspective. It wasn't all that long ago that I was a guy here about 12 years ago that showed up to this lake and had no clue how to navigate it or anything else. And I really tried to think of it when I was building this chip from a perspective of how would I want to get from here to there if I didn't know? What if I wanted to fish over there? What if I wanted to fish over here? Maybe I don't know. I want to fish over there. I really tried to put a lane in every corner of Lake Fork for you guys that want to learn the lake and get to know the lake. So worked really hard on it. Really, really proud of the results. Really, really proud of the results. It is available for pre-order right now. We're expecting to have those chips ready to deliver to you guys here in just a few weeks. Our target date is April 22nd at this point to have those delivered. I don't see any reason why we shouldn't be able to hit that target date at this time. But they're available for pre-order right now. And on pre-order, they're at a 20% discount over at yourlakefortguide.com. Go to the Shop My Gear tab at yourlakefortguide.com, and you can purchase those boat lanes chips right now for $80. Now, once we get to past pre-order time when we're shipping them out on a day-to-day basis, the price will be $100. I saw Todd Fleischer ask, are we going to have them available in stores? Yes, we are. We're going to have them available at Lake Fork Marina for sure right now. Don't know about any others, but I know at Lake Fork Marina they will be available there once we have them ready to go here in a few more weeks. So, yes, you will have a storefront at Lake Fork where you can purchase this product as well. So we're going to call them the Your Lake Fork Guide Pro Lanes, because if you want to come to Lake Fork for the first time and run that lake and navigate through that timber like a pro, you're going to need the Your Lake Fork Guide Pro Lanes. That's just how we're going to market it right there. So we'll just leave it at that. Let's move on to tonight's soft plastic discussion. Got a good number of people, almost up to 200 people between the two platforms. That's a beautiful thing. Cheers, you guys. Thank you for joining us. Let's talk about soft plastics and why they catch 70, 80, 90%. The vast majority of the fish that you catch are caught on soft plastics right now. Cheers, y'all. All right, why are soft plastics the deal? Well, pretty simple answer. Our fish starting to spawn. We all know that. Dogwoods are finally blooming. Everywhere you look, dogwoods are blooming. We just had a full moon. fish are getting on the beds. Did some sight fishing today. Fish are getting on beds. No doubt about it, and they will continue to be on beds, especially as later we started. We're going to have fish on beds all through April and probably through half of May this year, honestly. I mean, at least half of May. I would say maybe even more than that. Some scragglers even into June probably. But right now, you've got a huge percentage of fish that are on beds and some fish that are pre-spawn. A lot of fish that are on beds are really, really thinking about getting on beds, really close to getting on a bed. When that happens, these fish become immobile. When they get into these pockets and settle into these pockets where they're going to spawn, sometimes they may hang around in there for a month or more waiting for them to feel right and feel comfortable to go ahead and spawn. That is something that we know they do at times. So, but those fish get really, really stationary. They quit moving. They're not pulling up on a point to feed, then moving back out to timber. And then, you know, they're not roaming around chasing shad. They're just kind of sitting still. That is why soft plastics matter so much this time of year and why they catch so many fish. From weightless plastics, like stick bait style things like Senkos, from fluke style baits, wacky worms with wacky rig finesse worms, Texas rigs, soft plastic swim baits that you can swim slowly, especially bigger soft plastic swim baits that you can swim extremely slowly. All of these things, these soft plastic baits, catch a ton of fish this time of year for everybody that goes. It's no secret, everybody knows it. But the reason why, guys, is these fish become stationary. They become very, very stationary. And when they do, fish in a soft plastic, which is almost a stationary bait, you know, weightless plastic, Texas rig, things like that, man, that's how you catch the fish. You leave the bait in their face longer. We've all heard about keeping a bait in a strike zone longer, parallel in a bank to do this, keeping a bait in a certain depth throughout the day to keep your bait in a strike zone a higher percentage of the day. The way to do this is to keep the bait in a strike zone longer. When fish become stationary and sit still, is to have your bait sit still. It's really that simple. I think we overcomplicated things, a lot of things in bass fishing. And realistically, man, these fish aren't real smart. You know, like, hey, you ever eat a plastic hot dog or a metal hamburger? Like, these jokers do it every day or we wouldn't be doing this sport. We wouldn't be having this talk, you know. So they're not real smart and we overcomplicate things. And it's really that simple is when fish are sitting still, my God, slow down and let your bait sit still and you'll catch more fish. That's dumbing it down real simple, but let's get into some baits, some different types of baits and style of baits that I really like a lot this time of year. I lean on them day in, day out, just to let you guys know and kind of give you guys a leg up on what you need to have loaded up in your boat to be prepared for the next month and a half, 2 months of spawning type fishing when these fish are on spawning cycles in coves. Now, that's not to say that you won't be able to pull up and catch some staging fish on a point like we always do at Fork. That's going to be available too, but right now I'm going to tell you, probably the best bait to do that with right now is Carolina rig. Soft plastic, stationary bait. They're just not moving a whole lot right now, guys. So let's get into some of these baits. Now, before I get into this, let me say this. All these soft plastics I'm about to show you, not that there's not many great soft plastic companies out there, but you guys know I love Six Sense Fishing. I'm a Six Sense Fishing guy through and through. It's a family-run company. I know the owner very well. I actually went to high school with him. I know what kind of person he is. I know what kind of man he is. I know what he stands for. His products from day one, since they've come out, nobody would argue this. None of his worst competitors or anybody that would try to detract from them in any way, nobody can look you in the eye and tell you this. He makes crappy product. Nobody's ever going to say that. Six Sense Fishing, from the day they've come out, has made nothing but the highest of quality products. If they come out with product, it is as good or better than anything they're competing with on the market. They've always been that way. They're very, very adamant about making sure the quality is there in their baits. All these plastics are from Six Sense Fishing. And luckily for us, Six Sense Fishing has provided us with a discount code through Your Lake Fork Guide to save you guys a little money. So if you want to order some of the plastics we talked about tonight, please go to sixsensefishing.com, punch in the code Your Lake Fork Guide, and you will save 10% on all orders. That being said, let's get into this discussion. The two easiest ones to throw, and maybe the two most effective this time of year. Weightless plastics. Cinco style bait. This is the Clout stick bait right here. Clout stick bait from Six Sense Fishing. It's a little bit unique. It's a little bit more slender than a Cinco. It's got some unique ridges and ribs to it that give it a little bit different shimmy. With it being a little skinnier, having those different ridges to catch water a little differently, gives it a little different kick. It almost swims. Like when you pull it forward, it almost swims forward and then kind of kicks out. It's a different action. It's kind of a cross between a soft plastic jerkbait and a Cinco. It's a really good bait. We're getting an indigestion going on, you know what I'm saying? Had that Mexican food when I got off the water today, that's what it was. It does have the shimmy on the fall, like a traditional Cinco does, but it also has that swimming kick when you pull it forward. So really, really good dynamic bait, catches a lot of fish. Throwing that weightless Texas rigged on a 3-aught EWG hook. The EWG hook I use is a 6-inch hook. You can also find the hooks I use, by the way, at 6inchfishing.com. It's called a stout wide gap hook in the 3-aught size. That's what I'm using on my Clout. Gives it a very good fall rate. Gives it the right fall rate to get bites, and just a tremendously strong, beefy hook for a 3-aught size hook. That's the first one. Now, that's not an overlooked bait. It's really, really not an overlooked bait. Here's an overlooked bait. And I know a lot of guys throw a bait like that or a Cinco wacky style this time of year. But what I like to do personally is take a bait like this. This is the Divine Shaky Head Worm. It's just a 6.5-inch finesse style worm like you would throw on a shaky head. You guys have seen this for years. This one, however, comes with forward-facing ridges so that even though I'm fishing a very finesse bait, as this bait moves through the water column, it catches a little more water, adds a little bit more water displacement and vibration to a finesse technique, which I personally think is a good thing. What I'll do is take a 1/32 nail weight, I'll break it in half and shove it into the head, okay, of this bait. I will then rig it up on a wacky hook. The wacky hook I prefer is a Gamakatsu Finesse Wide Gap Weedless #1 size. Rig that up in the middle worm, put my nail weight in. This bait is gonna fall down, nose first with that nail weight, slowly sit on the bottom, kind of do this. And then slowly work its way down. And when it does that, I'm gonna twitch, 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 shake it up. It's gonna go, and then it's gonna go, fall back down. Let me tell you guys something about a bait that falls nose down. In a fish's world, nose down is an aggressive behavior. When a bass gets mad at your bait on a bed, what's it do? Bonk. When a bluegill wants to go raid a nest on a bed, what's it do? Bonk. It goes nose down. Nose down is an aggressive feeding behavior in a bass's world. If something's acting aggressive and feeding in front of a bass is an apex predator. What do you think it's going to do? It probably wants to slap the fire out of this stupid, tiny little bait that thinks it can come into its territory and go nose down. A bass wants to slap it. There's a problem. He doesn't have any hands. So he can't slap it. So what's he going to do? He's going to bite it, right? That's what they do. Wacky rigging this bait, putting a little nail weight in the head, putting a wacky hook on it. I know some guys do it, but it is a tremendously, tremendously overlooked and underrated technique. Zach Watts will be proud of me. This is his favorite technique, old Wacky Watts. Very, very overlooked technique this time of year. I mean, you want to talk about catch a lot of fish? Like, when they get on beds and they kind of don't want to bite anything because they're thinking about spawning, or they are spawning and you can't really see them because water's too dirty, which we're dealing with a little bit now in a lot of places. You want to catch them? Catch a lot of them? That's the deal. That's the deal right there. That wacky rig, Divine Shaky Head Worm will do it up for you. Now, think about this also. A few years ago, they came up with this thing called the Nico Rig. Everybody threw a fit about how effective the Nico Rig. What was a Nico Rig? It was a wacky hook in the middle of the worm and a weight in the head. Folks, we've been fishing a Nico Rig since I was a kid. Just a lighter, more finesse version of it. That's how we have been fishing a finesse Nico Rig since I was a kid, and it is the #1 bite getter. If somebody asked me, what bait can I throw to get the most number of bites any lake I go to, no matter what? That's it, right there. That's it. Wacky Rig, Divine Shaky Head Worm, half a nail weight in the head. That's the deal. Very overlooked. Top secret. Top secret guide stuff here, folks. All right, now let's talk about another bait. Now, this bait can be used a couple different ways this time of year. Really, really effective. This is going to be the Hog Walla from Sixth Sense Fishing. Hog Walla. As you can see, it has like a little, doesn't have the head of a lizard, but has the arms of a lizard. It has the tails kind of like a brush hog. It's got a little twin tail deal here, a little bit thinner than a brush hog. Since the day I got this bait in my hands, it's just a bite getter. Like, you just Texas rig it, you shaky head it, you Carolina rig it, it don't matter. Fish just bite a hog walla. Now, if I'm back in a pocket, spawning area where fish are stationary, I'm gonna fish this bait on a quarter ounce Texas rig right now, and I'm gonna catch a lot of fish, and you're gonna catch big fish. You're gonna be able to roll this bait up against stumps, lay downs, whatever you want, though, docks, anything shallow cover, doesn't matter, flooded bushes. This joker will straight up catch them. I mean, it will catch them, guys. And then also, again, like I say, some of the stuff we're dealing with now, spawning fish that we can't really see because of high winds and dirty water, right? We're dealing with that. This is a bait that if you drag this bait on a quarter ounce Texas rig through a bed, you got a good chance for a bed fish to bite this bait, and you're catching spawning bass, bedding bass without knowing that you're doing it. So very, very effective bait on a quarter ounce Texas rig this time of year. Switch gears for a minute. Let's go out and talk about the shallow points, shell beds. I forgot to get into the Lake Fork drama, didn't I? Stay tuned, folks. We'll get into some Lake Fork drama. I got a good one for you. Y'all don't let me forget in the comments. It's pretty funny. I think it's funny. These shallow point deals, especially early in the year, like right now, even though it's the end of March, we're early in the cycle. Like, we're late this year, so we're early in the spawning cycle, very, very early in the spawning cycle still. We should be in the meat of it right now. We're still very early. This little dude right here on the Carolina rig will straight up get you right. Early in the year on the shallow windblown points, tied on a big 1 ounce Carolina rig, when the wind's rocking those points, drag this thing along there. If there's a bass on it, he's going to bite it. And I can go to Toledo Bend and do this, and I can go to Sam Rayburn and do this, and Lord knows we go to Lake Fork and do it, and any other lake. If I pull up on a shallow point and drag this across there this time of year, if there's bass on it, he gonna bite it. It is just a fish catching dude. And then another bait that I use for bed fishing, and you can use it for just pitching and flipping as well, but I use it for bed fishing, and it has literally caught every bed fish for me that we've caught in my boat. And you guys know how I'm about sight fishing. And we've been pretty successful at sight fishing. It's caught every bed fish for me over the last couple years. Has been the Stroker Crawl from Sixth Sense Fishing. All right, one more little category we promised you guys. Swim baits. Swim. wrong pipe. Need to wash that down. Cheers, y'all. Swim baits. Line through swim baits are really good. My favorite line through is the Felon from Smash Tech Custom Baits. Line throughs are really good because they can move really slow, but a bait that you can throw anywhere, anywhere, and is extremely underutilized and underrated, top secret guide stuff here now. A bait that's extremely underutilized and underrated is the Whale from Sixth Sense Fishing. It's a great color right here called Electric China. Really like this color. Also throw it in platinum white. Been throwing it in platinum white a lot on Lake Fork because we've had dirtier water. But two of my favorite colors, Electric China, platinum white. But this Whale, out of all the Sixth Sense swim baits and plastics, is maybe the most underrated and underutilized bait out there. Now, you guys know, on Lake Fork especially, having a bait that everybody else ain't throwing can sometimes make all the difference in the world. This little joker right here will catch them. I'm rigging them up on a 5-aught belly-weighted hook. I like a 5-aught on a flashy swimmer a lot. Also like just a regular 5-aught keel-weighted belly-weighted hook. The key to this bait is, even though it's a smaller swim bait, what is it, 4.5 inches? 4.5-inch swim bait, not a big swim bait at all. It has the action and attitude of a bigger swim bait. It's got the fins like the big swim baits have. It just has kind of the shape and the tail kick, and you can swim it slowly and still get a good wag out of the tail. Again, fish are stationary. I need a bait that I can move slowly to stay in their face a little longer. If I just can't stand to slow down enough with the other plastics, man, I can pick up the whale, still get my winding in, but I can fish it slow enough to get bites when fish are stationary. So, there you, excuse me, I apologize. I'm kind of losing my voice a little bit because I keep yelling at these kids on the soccer field so much. And let's be honest, this time of year you get a lot of drainage in your sinus nasal cavities because it's spring and things are blooming. Probably doesn't help that I'm always touching greasy fishing baits and putting it to my mouth, my fingers in my face. But anyways, got off track a little bit there. These are baits that you guys can use right now. Soft plastics, soft plastics, soft plastics, man. They are money. They catch probably 70 to 80, maybe even 90% of the bass that get caught this time of year, get caught on soft plastics by the overall population of bass fishermen in this region. So please do go load up on soft plastics. Go visit sixinchfishing.com. You're supporting a great Texas-born, Texas-owned, will always be in Texas company. Good people running that operation down there. Go check them out, sixinchfishing.com. Use that code, Your Lake Fork Guide, get your 10% discount. I'll sure appreciate it. Six Sense will appreciate it. And in the end, even you guys are going to appreciate it because y'all going to catch some fish on them baits. I can promise you that. Come on with the drama. Here we go. Come on with the drama. Oh, man. Somebody said something about love the new Six Sense video you did for flipping the prawns and the stroker. I honestly forgot I filmed that. But, yeah, we did film a video Mr. Luis a while back. Dude, we got Josh Jones in the house. Josh Jones in the house. What up, JJ? Big JJ in the house. My man, the legend. The legend. Appreciate you joining us. Go check out the Six Sense Fishing YouTube channel, guys, because they are putting instructionals up, and I've been fortunate enough. I don't know why they let me do it, but they're kind of bringing themselves down a little bit, lowering their level. But I've been fortunate enough they let me do a couple quick instructional videos that they filmed and have posted on the Six Sense Fishing website. So if you like stuff we do here, you'll love the stuff there because it's professional quality, professional editing, all that good stuff. So go check out some of the instructional videos from guys like myself, Lee Livesey. I don't know if Josh has done any instructionals on there or not yet, but I'm sure he's on the channel somewhere. I mean, they're coming out with content constantly, multiple times a week now, and it's good informative content for you guys. So check that out. Let me get a little sip before we get into the drama. Y'all want some drama? Here we go. So as we said in the beginning, I've been working on a boat lanes chip. And it's no secret. I told you guys about it. I've told everybody around the lake that I was doing it. I thought it was a great idea. I was like, dude, lake 6 foot low, this is a unique opportunity to open this lake up and let people navigate the entire lake. It's a good opportunity. I would have wanted to do it for myself, even if I didn't do it for everybody else. So I thought it was a wonderful opportunity to create navigation assistance, right? So I worked my butt off on it, and it's no secret. There's, you know, new ones that have come out. Curtis Daniels came out with one called Super Trails or whatever it's called. And I've talked to Curtis, and I like Curtis. I've known Curtis for years, and we get along, and I've never had an issue with Curtis. And I support him, and hopefully his product does well for him. You know, I've talked to Curtis, and I know for a fact that I've gone further into creeks and done more trails than he has, and I know that ours are set up differently. His trails are not really constructed the same way mine are, with the different lake levels and the hazard waypoints and, you know, stuff like that. I've just done some things differently on mine. And that's all good. It's, we need variety out there in the market. But, dude, I don't understand why people are constantly, like, they just actively are trying to tear somebody down. And this guy didn't go out of his way to try to tear me down. In fact, he didn't even mention me, but it's obviously very targeted what he's doing. And so it's just, honestly, at the end of the day, it's funny because since I started here, since I started making social media content, I've always had guys around the lake that have tried to tear me down and soil my reputation and tell everybody what a bad guy I was and I was the worst there ever was and da-da-da-da-da, whatever. You know, it goes on and on. I don't want to go into all that. What's funny is almost all those guys have kind of given up on that at this point, and I think pretty much what they do is just try to ignore me and forget that I exist because I annoy them, which is fine. That's great. I mean, I like that. That's a lot better. But I think they've just given up on trying to run me out of here, so to speak, because they realized I'm not going anywhere. Like, they can't get rid of me, so I think they're just kind of giving up. But then there's some that just won't let it go, man. And anytime I try to do something, they've got to try to one-up me or knock mine down. Old McGoober. There's been a guide going around. And you know what's funny is people ask me, what about McGoobers? Well, listen, I don't need calling names. What about McFarland's boatland ship? Guys, Mike McFarland didn't make a boatland ship. And he never said he made a boatland ship, to be fair to him. But sorry, I was reading a comment. But he's been promoting Curtis Daniels ship, the Super Lane ship. That's great. No problem. No work. Good. What's funny is he promoted it a couple times and did a couple videos for Curtis, and I don't know if Curtis is paying him or if it's just a friendship. But sure, it's just a friendship deal, and that's all well and good. But literally all I did yesterday was post a screenshot of a small section of the lake stating that we had pre-orders available. That's all I did. One picture of a screenshot. That's all I did. And then there's this... what's the right word here? Very detailed post, very pointed post from Mike talking about how great the Super Trails is and how much he trusts, uses, and endorses them. And it's just obvious that, you know, he did that on the same day or the next morning after I made my post. And it's just like, okay, like why? I haven't said anything about, I'm still not saying anything bad about the Super Trails. I'm not trying to knock it in any way. I wish Curtis the best of luck with it. I told him that to his face and shook his hand, you know? Why are you trying to come at me, dog? Because that's obvious that's what that was. You ain't said nothing about the Super Trail since Bass Pro Tour left. Now all of a sudden I make mine. Now you got to post yours. Like, okay. Like, you want to compare them? We compare them. I mean, they're different products. Me and Curtis have been talking about they're totally different products. So they're not intended to even do the same thing. And just... some people just can't let it go, man. And as far as his endorsement goes, I mean, I don't know. I'm not going to get into it. I'm not going to hate on him. But if you want to trust that endorsement, that's up to y'all, you know. When guys are doing things with that motivation behind it, it ought to tell you a lot. It ought to tell you a lot about what the meaning is behind it and what the intention is behind it. It ain't got nothing to do with how good or bad what they're promoting is. It strictly has to do with them wanting to get at the other guy. It's ugly. It's not cool. You know, I've gone back and forth with Mike. Y'all know he used to do videos with me. Then he got mad at me. And then he did new videos with me. Then he trashed me. Then we were cool. And I'm just tired of going back and forth with him. The guy's just, he's up and down. You know, it is what it is. Well, I wish Mike the best of luck. Hope everything goes great for him. And I'm sure it will, you know. And I'm sure that, you know, maybe he would admit this, maybe he wouldn't. But I know that I helped him a lot with, you know, how to actually get his own trips and build a little bit of a social media base, and even though it's not big, it's working for him, and that's all you need in the guide business, and he's doing well with that, and I hope he continues to do well with that. It's just annoying. Like, dude, I helped you a lot back in the day. Why you got to keep coming at me? Like, you do your thing, I'll do mine. You ain't got to keep coming at me. Stop it. It's just silly. Lake Fork drama. I thought it was funny that he went out of his way to make a post, like, because I put a screenshot out there. Now, you think that's bad? Oh, wait, there's more, buddy. Like, I got a lot more marketing coming behind this guy, Chip. And Josh, I seen Josh Jones said, the haters make us money. He's absolutely right. They do, because the more they hate on you, the more attention it puts on you. And not everybody's going to hate you. What's that old fishing movie, Bait Shop? Hot Rod don't need everybody to love him. Well, neither does your Lake Fork guide or Josh Jones or, you know, whoever. You don't need everybody to love you, that's for sure. They give you more attention. And a percentage of those people enjoy your content or find value in your content, then by God, you just grew, and they grew it for you. So it just all works out in the end, man. Josh is right about that. And Josh would know. That guy gets more hate and more just ridiculous, like obscene hate for no reason other than that Joker's catching more giants than anybody else. It's pretty crazy. Lots of folks in here tonight. Lots of folks in here tonight. Little Mustang is tricky right now, dude. The whole lake's tricky to run right now, other than, you know, some obvious stuff out in the main lake. Other than that, the whole lake's tricky to run. That's why I think these bow lane ships are so valuable. And I'll be honest with you guys, I mean, part of me wants to just tell you, get them all. Get them all. Get all the information you can and see what lines up where and you know, what lines you're comfortable running. The one thing I would tell you with all of them, mine included, you need to take it easy when you're first learning these lanes, no matter what, until you're comfortable on the lake and you're comfortable, you know, navigating and keeping your boat. Like, I don't mean this as a slight to anybody, but we spend hundreds of days a year in a boat for years and years of our life. We're really good at controlling that boat and knowing exactly how far zoomed in or out we are on our mapping, on our electronics unit to see where our boat is exactly in comparison to that line. It's not an easy thing to keep your boat on right on that line on some of these narrow alleys that we run on Lake Fork through this timber. So when you first get these lanes, you need to be going slow on all of them until you know you can keep your boat on that line and you're always aware of how far zoomed in or zoomed out. I can't tell you how important it is to be aware of how far zoomed in or zoomed out you are on your mapping system. If you're needing to stay tight to a lane, that little increment deal in the bottom corner needs to be at 100 feet. No, like minimum. You can go tighter than that, but then the map kind of glitches sometimes depending on what unit you have. My units don't, but some units do. Certainly no more than 200 feet on that little increment in the bottom right corner. You got to be sharp. So good thing about our lanes that I feel like is a very good thing is when there's hazards near, we have them marked. So you can go and understand that if there's no hazard waypoints on that line, you've got some variance on that line, okay? If there's hazard waypoints and they start tightening up on that line, you might want to slow down and even idle, especially first few times through. I mean, I've said that before, but I'm going to keep saying it so you guys understand because I want y'all to be safe. And also understand that the lines that are marked at 3 foot low and above are not safe to run right now. I don't care how tight you are to the line. They're not safe to run at this current level. When we get to 3 foot low and higher, they'll be safe to run. Going back to baits, what weight do you suggest on a kill weighted whale? Man, as light as you can get away with, whatever the lightest belly weighted hook you can find in a 5-aught hook. I like a 5-aught hook in it because it's got a pretty beefy body. Pretty beefy body on that bait right there. So I like a 5-aught hook. But, you know, I tend to use the Owner Flashy Swimmer and the Owner Beast hooks. And those are great swim bait hooks. 6-inch does make a swim bait hook, but their kill weight is a little bit heavier than I like on that 5-aught. So I do tend to use the Owner Beast, if I'm being honest with you. I mean, that's, you know, listen, I'm sponsored by 6-inch. I love their products. They make great products. But the reality is I'm going to use some different stuff sometimes, and I'm going to tell you when I do. How many stumps did I hit making the chip? None. I mean, I idled over stumps, but how many stumps? Guys, here's the thing. When you think about my boat lanes chip, I want you to think about this. I have been running all over Lake Fork for years and years now at different lake levels. Once, one time, I hit a stump on plane. One time, and I hit a stump. And it was when the lake dropped in the fall, and I kept making a run out to an offshore spot through some timber, and it just dropped enough for me to barely clip it one time. And I just barely clipped it, and it just did a little bit of, bit my prop shaft just a little bit. I mean, it just was like, I was just driving, went, like it wasn't nothing. It was like, it's like you hit a wave. And I didn't even realize I did any damage until I took it in for my next hourly maintenance. They're like, oh, your prop shaft's been a little bit. Well, that's when it happened. But in all these years, all these different lake levels, running all over the lake, top to bottom, some of you guys have seen me run some stuff that's like, I've hit one stump on plane. So I'm very cautious. I'm one of the more cautious guys out there when it comes to that, and when it comes to navigating, I think. So you can also have comfort in that when you're looking at my boat lens chip, is I made it with that in mind. I don't want to hit a stump ever, dude. My boat goes down in the middle of a guide week, I'm out thousands of dollars. So I don't want to go down. And I don't want you guys to go down. Now, I'm not telling you that nobody's ever going to hit a stump using my boat lanes chip. It's probably going to happen because somebody's going to go out there and run them lanes too fast, especially where the hazard waypoints are tight, and they're going to smoke one. It's probably going to happen. Like I said, it is a very much use-at-your-own-risk product, but it gives you more information than anything else. We've talked a lot about boat lanes. By the way, you can find them. They're available for pre-order for Lowrance only right now. We got to do the conversion on Hummingbird, make sure we've got all the bugs and kinks out of that before we offer it to sell. Like, we're not going to offer something for you guys to sell unless we know 100% sure we can deliver it. Jerry Dean, let me come back to that. So, yeah, we're going to make sure that. Right now it's available for pre-order for Lowrance only. Pre-order for Hummingbird and Garmin will be coming as soon as we know we can get the conversion right. Justin DuBose asks, how much is the new chip? Pre-order is $80. Once we're out of the pre-order phase, it'll be $100. But it is taking a lot more time to do and has a lot more information than the other ones. The midsection of Little Caney is sketchy. Your chip got a safe run through there. So here's what I did in the midsection of Little Caney. In the midsection of Little Caney, it does get sketchy. It's not safe to run in part of it right now. So my run up Little Caney is much like Lance Vick's run. It's the same line, essentially. It's basically the same line as Lance Vick's run. Very, very close. So my run up Little Caney follows that. But in that middle section right now, it changes colors. So like right now on my graph, I've got it marked green and red. And we may change those colors, see what's more visible, play with what colors they are before we deliver it to market. But right now, I run a green line. Green means it's good at 6 foot low and above. I run that green line, and when it turns red, I'm off plane. I idle the section that's red, and then when I get back to green, I can run again all the way up to where everybody runs to. That red section, once we're at 3 foot low and above, will then be safe to run. You'll be able to run the whole thing. But while it's low, you'll know that in that red section, I gotta idle right here. That's not safe at 6 foot low. Not safe at 5 foot low, because it's not. And the thing is with the other chips right now, it's just one line. And you don't know if it's good at 2 foot low or 1 foot low or 4 foot low or five. You don't know. There's no way to know. So I think we've built a better mousetrap. I really do. And the reason I'm so confident that it is better is because I don't think anybody else is going to take the crazy obsessive amount of time that it took for me to idle all over that lake doing this chip into every daggum corner I could go into. I mean, there's little sections that you can run way back in creeks, like you have to idle, but then for this little section you can go ahead and run, but then go ahead and idle the rest of the way. Like anything I could do to save you time and help you navigate, put it on that chip. This has turned into the boat lanes chip live stream. Do I plan on doing boat lanes on other lakes in the future? I don't plan on it because I don't have the time on the water, okay? And I honestly don't have the time to go spend on the water. I mean, it'll be years and years from now. Maybe someday when my kids are grown, I might do it. No, it's not something I plan on doing. I just don't have the time on those other bodies of water. I mean, I could do like a general boat lanes on a Toledo and Rayburn. I know those lakes well enough to give you a general boat lanes, but I'm not going to give you anything that's better than what Lance Vick does. What Lance Vick does has been great. I mean, what he's done is great. I'm not going to do something unless I feel like I can add some value to you guys. And I can't add value over what Lance has done on Rayburn and Toledo. Not at all. Don't spend enough time on those lakes. The deal is you got to spend years on these lakes and see them at different water levels to understand these lanes in and out of this timber. And you really need to mark them while the lake is low, which is why I did it now, because we had that unique opportunity. Brad Lamar says, now we need to figure out how to combine boat lanes with fish life. Well, you know, we actually did consider that when we were coming up with this plan. I mean, this is a, you know, I have a company. So I have a guide business that's kind of like Billy Lawson Lake Fort Guide, even though I'm called Your Lake Fort Guide. And then I actually have a company that's called Your Lake Fort Guide, Inc. It's a corporation. It owns the app, and I have partners in that corporation. So this chip is owned by that corporation. So, of course, we have a vote and all that. We were actually considering how could we put this on the app? The issue with that is I wouldn't want to navigate while I'm running on plane in my boat via phone, even if it's mounted or whatever. I want my full map screen on my electronics unit to be my navigation tool. So I didn't think that it would be a viable or a good option to put it on the app. I thought it would be better to have it where you can have a SD card and pop it into the graph and it's on your map. I thought that was a necessity. We needed to have that. So have I used flushes for bedfish? Not for visually looking at them and catching them. Now, a flush, which is a fluke style bait by 6 Cents, another good soft plastic on topic for tonight. I do use it fishing around spawning areas where fish are spawning a lot, but I'm not visually looking at the fish when I'm throwing the flush. I'm just kind of throwing it at areas that they might spawn in, throwing it at areas that look good in shallow water in spawning areas. It's very effective that way. I'll tell you guys something else. So here's a bonus top secret bait for you guys. Now, it's not time for it yet, but as these fish move offshore after the spawn, put a flush on a scrounger head. Old scrounger head. Put a flush on a scrounger head and do yourself a favor and try that. Something we don't ever really talk about. It's real good. Tyler Strader wants to ask, how wide do you think your boat lanes are just in case you slide off path? You're going to slide off the trail at times on any trail. I do it on my lanes. Everybody does. The deal with ours is if it's a reasonably tight hazard, it's important to always stay tight to those lanes. It is important to always stay tight to those lanes. But you're going to have some wiggle room unless you see a hazard waypoint. If you see a hazard waypoint, which we just use the tree icon on Lowrance, a little pine tree looking thing, a little tree icon. It's what we used on Lowrance. If you see one of those hazard waypoints, then you know how much room you have. And at times, it's tight, tight, tight. At times, it's fairly forgiving. But if it's within a reasonable distance of that lane, then we marked it. I marked it. So you got to stay tight to the line. Yeah, you do. But you'll be able to have some variance in the areas where you're not seeing hazard waypoints. And I'll make some videos showing you guys these lanes on my graph. That's coming. That is coming very soon. So you guys will know and be more comfortable knowing exactly how you need to use it. Yep, Friday night we got a seminar. Avery Gatton says he's coming, save him a seat up front. I'll do my best, dog. Last time we ran out of seats, standing room only type deal. If we have good weather, we might do it outside just to get some more room because we are running out of room. We are filling up the entire marina store with people at these seminars, which is awesome. So if you want to come, get there early. We got a free seminar this Friday. I think Cord Hudkins is going to do this one with me this week. We might line up another guest as well. Come on to the free seminar. We're going to have a good time, talk fishing like we always do. You guys get to hang out with us in person, ask questions in person. You know, I used to get asked back in the day, YouTube meetups was a thing. They were like, hey, man, you ever going to do a YouTube meetup? I'm like, bro, I do one every other Friday, Lake Fork Marina. Come on, Jack. Like, you know what I mean? We'll give you some tips and do a seminar, you know? So it's just a good opportunity, man. I love meeting you guys. If you've never been to one, I sure would appreciate if you would come because I really thoroughly enjoy meeting the people that watch the channel. It's cool. I do it. I meet people all the time. It's funny. I had my kids over spring break, and Saturday we had a soccer game, and then afterwards we went over to this little family fun park thing, and I'm just going there to play video games, ride go-karts with my kids, and guy walks up to me and goes, hey man, are you Billy Lawson? And listen, I think it's awesome, man. I appreciate it when you guys come in. He's like, man, I'm sorry for bothering you. Dude, you're not bothering me. You're not bothering me a bit. I mean, yeah, I'm there with my kids and all that, but I don't mind a bit. I enjoy meeting you guys. So these seminars are a great opportunity for me to meet you guys. So I appreciate it when y'all come. So please do if you're in the area. It's a good time. We have a good time. Have I ever fished with Jacob Prosnick? I sure haven't. I did meet Jacob Prosnick last year's Classic. I've never fished with him, though. I would love to. Guys are obviously really good. Ken Simpson says, only problem is your tree icons getting mixed up with all my tree icons. Yeah, yeah, that might be a problem. Jay Hasty, thank you, thank you. Dude, we got over 250 people in this live stream between the two platforms. I just can't thank y'all enough, man. Love you guys, dude. Thank you so much. That means a lot to me. I mean, I'm beat down, tired right now. You probably hear it in my voice. I'm just really, really worn out. These Tuesdays are long days. I get up in the morning, I go guide all day. I come straight off the lake, go straight into soccer practice. Came straight home from soccer practice. Didn't have time to eat tonight before I started getting ready to do this live stream. Knock this live stream out. By the time I'm done, it's going to be 10 o'clock. And then I still got to shower and eat and go to bed and then make sure I got content ready to go for tomorrow, Wednesday night content. And then I got to go to bed and get up and go guide again. It just is a lot. It's a lot. It's what they say. It ain't no 9 to 5. It's a 5 to 9. And this is like a 5 to midnight, really. I mean, it's pretty crazy. So, I do appreciate you guys, and hopefully it shows by the dedication that I try to give you guys by doing these. And I do apologize for missing the last couple weeks. To be honest with you guys, last one that I missed, last couple live streams I missed last week, had my kids over spring break, would get them home for soccer practice, and I just, to be honest with you, couldn't pull myself away from my children in the evening to come do these, if I'm just being straight up. I wanted those. We were having spring break. We were playing. We were having good times, even in the evenings. I was still having to work through a lot of their spring break, so we didn't get to travel and go do all that vacation stuff. So I really just couldn't pull myself out of the house to come do a live stream out here in the garage with you guys, and I apologize for that. But, you know, there ain't a whole lot I'm going to put over my work because I love it so much. By God, them two kids is certainly one thing that I will. So. Thank you guys for the kind comments that are coming in. Looking forward to the, can you convince Sixth Sense to make some watermelon red tomato baits? Watermelon red tomato. We can look into that. I can ask. I can certainly ask. Watermelon red tomato. Looking forward to fishing the 4th of July weekend. How are things coming along for this year's Forever Grateful Tournament? Man, thanks for coming along. It's going to be like always. We're planning on trying to have a concert again on Friday. Last year, we did a concert on Friday night registration. It turned into a daggum party. Everybody had a blast. We're attempting to do that again and pull that off again. It's not easy to do when we're just at an old marina out there trying to put on a concert. But last year, we pulled it off thanks to Billy Joe. She was a local lady who's actually just a friend of ours and did that for us for free. So, that was really great of her. Now, I know this year she can't come because she is booked out of state that weekend already. So we're going to try to put together another act for you guys, find somebody that can do it. And it's going to be the same. It's going to be the same. We're going to try to grow it. We're going to have more donations. And you guys will hear more about that as the year goes along and we pull together the details. We're going to have more sponsors and, you know, more donations and try to promote this thing. And we got something else coming down the pipe. You know, we never stop working around here. You know, I can't really tournament fish the Lake Fork tournaments, and to be honest with you, my children and everything, I don't have the schedule to travel and tournament fish at all. Even if I wanted to, I couldn't do it in the fashion that I would want to. But I think there's a opening. As many tournaments as there are, tournament trails as there are, if somebody does it the right way and works hard enough at it, I think there's an opening for a somewhat unique tournament trail for amateur, for weekend guys. And I think we're going to try to put it together. There might be a Your Lake Fork Guide tournament trail in the works. Maybe. Just maybe. So, we never going to stop working right here. We see an opportunity to make better boat lanes for you guys, we're going to do it. We see an opportunity to make a unique tournament trail and offer something different to you guys, we're going to do it. We're just going to try and provide this fishing community with everything that we can because we are so appreciative of it and we just love it. So we're going to keep doing it. So y'all stay tuned. We got more coming, man. I saw somebody ask if I caught them today. Not really. Not really. I mean, that storm, golly, dude, it raised so much hell last night. And to be honest with you, I ran from the wind, man. I did not fish Lake Fork today. I went to a lake where I knew I could get out of the wind and kind of fish the way that I want to fish, which is looking at them, which was tough after an all-night storm. And the area I went to got hit harder by the storm than Lake Fork did. And retrospect, I might have should have stayed on Lake Fork and just dealt with the wind and not sight fished. But I wanted to look at them. And we looked at them. We caught some quality fish. We just didn't catch a whole bunch. Didn't catch any real great big ones. I mean, it wasn't a bad day, but it wasn't a great day. You know, we have very high standards this time of year. Like, if I don't catch a 25-pound bag, at least 20-pound bag, this time of year, I'm kind of going home with my head down a little bit. I've had so much success catching fish this time of year when they're spawning in the past on Lake Fork that I'm spoiled. And if we don't catch my 25-pound bag, I just kind of am disappointed. It's kind of a daily routine when they get on beds. For me, I mean, I like sight fishing. I guess I've kind of become somewhat proficient at it. But I really enjoy it, and I do it a lot, and it works out for me. I catch a lot of big fish doing it. So wasn't a bad day. Wasn't a bad day, but was, I mean, we had a decent five fish limit, but it wasn't anything to get excited about. I don't know what we had. It was somewhere between 15 and 20. I really wasn't keeping up with it too well because we weren't catching any big ones. So just several solid fish. What size scrouger head would I use with the flush? It would depend on the size. I mean, depend on the depth I'm trying to fish when I'm talking about offshore structure. I mean, up to a 3/4 ounce, down to a 3/8 ounce. Just depends on the depth I'm trying to fish and how fast and the wind and all those different things. A lot of these things, when you guys ask us, what's the one bait for this or what's the one way to rig that? Man, It just depends on conditions and situations. You know, that's part of what we do as fishermen and fishing guys and full-time fishing dudes is make decisions based on what's in front of us. And I think if you put a staple on something or put a box around something and say, I'm going to do it this way, well, that's when you get yourself in trouble and you struggle a lot. I think you got to keep an open mind in this game. You got to be willing to try different things and adjust accordingly to the conditions at hand. You know, if it's dead calm and I want to throw a scrounger head and just kind of hop it off the bottom and let it fall slower, man, I might fish a 3/8 ounce scrounger head out deep even. If I'm fishing it a little bit shallower on a hump that comes up higher, a pond dam or something, yeah, then the 3/8 is going to be my deal anyway because I don't want it to get that deep. If I'm wanting to fish it 20 foot of water on a wind, you know, somewhat windy day and wanting to keep it down close to the bottom, then I'm going to go all the way up to a 3/4, maybe even a 1 ounce, probably about 3/4 ounce on a flush will keep it down pretty good. But, yeah. Got it. You got it. I mean, that's what this game's all about, decisions. trusting your instincts, thinking outside the box, being creative to get bites. First thing is locate the fish. Then get creative on how to get bites and make adjustments based on conditions and fish efficiently in the situation you're in. That's basically this game in a nutshell. Some are better at it than others, you know. A lot of them are better at it than me, that's for sure. A lot of guys on Lake Fork are better at it than me, to be quite honest with you. They really are. So, man, I think I'm going to wrap it up. I got to go in there and get cleaned up, get something to eat, go to bed. And tomorrow we're going to catch them better than we did today. That's all we can hope for, man. That's all we can hope for. Tomorrow we're going to go get that 25-pound bag. The guys I got with me tomorrow have actually caught some big bags this time of year before. The first time they came, I think they had a 35-pound bag. First time they came with me. So we've had some big sacks with this group tomorrow. So we'll see if we can't get this old father and son pair on some big ones tomorrow, man. Thank you, guys. Thank you, guys. Seriously, thank y'all so much. I'm sure I'm not the easiest guy to follow at times, but you guys have stuck with me for over 5 years now, and I can't appreciate it enough. I love every one of you. I really do. I love the opportunity I get to do what I love every day, and I will never. I mean, I may take a pause every once in a while, but I will never, ever, ever stop working as hard as I can to try and help you guys catch more and bigger fish and love my fellow man. That's what we will always be about here. We'll see you guys next time right here on Your Lake Fork Guide.